How do mathematicians model the spread of an infectious disease? Complicating matters is that different types of diseases have all sorts of different characteristics, and those characteristics need to be reflected in the equations that mathematicians use. In this video, I want to talk about a bunch of different variants of a very standard model called the SIR model, the Susceptible Infectious Recovered Model. This is a model that I actually introduced in a previous video, and indeed it had a lot of commentary given the current global situation. In this video, I'm going to very briefly remind you about that model, and more importantly, I want to look at all the variations on that model as we talk about different types of diseases. So, how did the SIR model work? It imagined first that there was a category of people called susceptibles, and those are all the people at time t that are capable of getting the disease. And then from those susceptibles, a proportion would become infectious people, those that are going to go around and continue to spread the disease. And then those infectious people would go on to become recovered people. This term is euphemistic, but it refers to both people who recover from the disease and unfortunately those that pass away from it. So the idea was that all people would be in one of these three categories. And then the way that we captured this mathematically in the SIR model was a system of differential equations. The way this worked is that we had three different rates of change. ds dt, the so-called derivative of s with respect to t, is the way that mathematicians describe a rate of change in the number of susceptible people as time goes on. And then there's actually three equations, one for the rate of change of susceptibles, one for the rate of change of infectious, and one for the rate of change of recovered. Then for the equations, we begin with this minus ASI term. The idea is that every time you have an interaction between a susceptible person and an infectious person, those interactions are more likely based on the number in both of those classes multiplied together, then a proportion A of those are going to become infectious. And then if that is the numbers that are leaving the susceptible terms, you get the addition of those in the infectious category. Then as time goes on, the infectious people are going to heal and they're going to have a subtraction proportional to the size of the infectious. That is, the more infectious people there are, the more those people get recovered. And so you lose a proportionality constant B times as I, and then you've gained that down in the recovered people now, where the people that transition out of infectious become recovered. So that was the standard model. But what I want to do now is modify that to improve or tweak it in different scenarios. The first variant of this I'm going to consider is called the SEIR model. There's now a fourth category, this exposed category. The reason for this category is that when you first get infected with a disease, often you don't immediately have symptoms and may not be actually spreading the disease to others. You may not currently be infectious. Nevertheless, you've actually received it. It's sort of a latency period as the infection is developing within somebody. After some time, these exposed people would then transition to be infectious where they were able to infect other people and then recovered after that. Okay, so let's see how we can model this with differential equations. I now have four different equations, a rate of change of SEIR, making the SEIR model. It's very similar to the old model, but there's a couple things have changed. First thing that changed is that after a susceptible person comes in contact with an infected person, they transition into the exposed state. So this plus ASI that used to be in the infected rate of change equation is now in the exposed rate of change equation. Secondly, in the exposed category, there's this minus C times E term. The idea is that at some rate proportional to the amount of expecteds, that is some constant C times E, people are going to leave the exposed category and move to the infectious category. Then in the infectious category, those people are added back in, so the minus CE in the exposed gets added to the infectious. Now, this current model actually assumes that an exposed person does not infect a susceptible person at all. But depending on the disease, that might not be true. It might be that an exposed person still infects a susceptible person, just perhaps at less of a rate than an infectious person. That is, if you're coughing, you might be more likely to infect a susceptible than if you're not coughing. So we could deal with this by adding another pair of terms here. I could have an interaction between susceptibles and exposed could infect a proportion of those susceptible people, maybe a proportionality constant of D. And if you subtract those people out of the susceptible category, you add them back into the exposed category. One other variant that I'm not going to write down might be that some people can have very mild symptoms and can go from exposed all the way to recovered, that would never get sick enough to be in the infectious category. And similarly, you could add extra terms to represent that possibility. One way of thinking about these middle two terms, the one that talk about the exposed and the infectious, is that we're taking what used to be one category and breaking up into two other categories, a sort of submodel, if you will. This process could actually become quite a bit more complex. You might want to have many of these subcategories here. For example, you could imagine a third category of sort of infected people, those that were so sick that they went to the hospital, and then as a result of being in isolation, their chance of infecting a susceptible person would go down. So you could add a whole other equation for that. Okay, so let me go back to the original SIR model, and I want to modify this in a very different direction than the SEIR model that we just talked about. Here I want to imagine that there's natural births and natural deaths. I'm going to, for instance, consider a situation where new people get born, and when you're born, you're just come in as susceptible. You don't come in infected, you don't come in recovered, you come into the world as susceptible to some disease. And then, no matter which category you are in, it's quite possible that you pass away for natural reasons. You could get into a car accident, say. And as a result, out of each of these categories, there's some unfortunate rate at which people are passing away. So how do we model that in our equation? Well, consider the following. Well, this model is called the SIR model with vital dynamics. Vital dynamics is this new piece we're going to add in. And I'm going to give a piece of terminology here. I'm going to let mu be the birth rate or the rate at which people are passing away. For simplicity here, I'm going to actually imagine the birth rate and the death rate is the same, so I'm sort of a constant population, if you will. And then I will refer to the total number of people, people in all three categories, the S plus the I plus the R, as being equal to the value of N. Okay, so now I'm going to modify my equations and get the following. There's a bunch of new terms here. The first term I have is a plus mu times N. And the idea here is that all new births become susceptible, as we saw in the previous diagram, and as a result, anybody in any of the three categories, so the N, which represents the sum of them, with a proportionality constant mu could give birth and create a new human in the susceptible category. And then I add these three other terms that refer to people passing away naturally, and they're proportional to the number of people in each of those three different categories, respectively. This SIR model with vital dynamics can be extremely useful for diseases like chickenpox. Chickenpox is a disease that primarily spreads among children. Every year, there are new children born, and so older siblings pass it down to younger siblings, or it spreads within schools. And there's this continual birth rate, these new populations of susceptible people to chickenpox that are then going to go and get it. One other direction we could go with the SIR model, again, I put the standard SIR model here, is with the idea of vaccines. Indeed, with our current crisis, vaccines is a big thing that people are hoping for. Imagine, for instance, that we develop the ability to give 10,000 vaccines per unit of time. Perhaps a unit of time is a day. Then what I can do is basically take susceptible people and convert them to being recovered by this idea of vaccinations. It skips the infectious stage. So what I'm going to do is basically subtract 10,000 in the DSDT. That means that as time goes on, there's less and less and less susceptible, 10,000 per day. And then I add to the recovered category the same 10,000 per unit time, per day in this case. So these two new terms, these constant terms, represent a way that we could deal with vaccines. What's nice about this is that if you look at the infectious category, where these vaccines may not appear to be relevant, but they actually are, because in the infectious category, there's an S stuck there. And then the hope is that this S is going to get small enough so that when you analyze the DIDT, that one person ends up infecting less than one other person, and therefore the infection is going to die down. Clearly, the more vaccines you're going to be able to give in a unit time, the faster this is going to happen. One other thing that can happen, and it depends again on the disease, is there might not be a recovered population. This is the case, for example, with the common cold. You can get it over and over and over and over again, and you getting the cold once does not mean you're recovered from the cold forever. This could be because the disease is mutating fast enough that you get new versions of it, or it could be that for whatever reason the antibodies you get from fighting it off once don't persist long-term in your immune system. Nevertheless, susceptible people transmit to infectious people, and then infectious people leave that category and become that susceptible again. Okay, so how could we model that with our equations? Well, consider the following. I want to have just two equations, because I'm saying there's just two categories, the susceptibles and the infectious. And the only thing that is new is that previously, that plus BI term, that's the term at which people leave the infectious category, previously that plus BI term was put down into the recovered state, but now I've added it back into the susceptible case. Now, these different models were all fun to play around with, but the truth is, it's actually way more complicated than I'm letting on in this video. Even at the level of writing down these differential equations, the true model for many different types of diseases is probably some big complicated mixture of many of them. It's not just an SIS or an SIR somewhere in between. It's something that's got maybe multiple different stages, like when I added in the exposed category. You want to talk about vital dynamics and other factors as well. But even that is too much of a simplification. For example, consider all of the constants in these systems of differential equations. How do you figure out the constants? Well, a best case scenario would be to do some sort of curve fitting against real world data. But what if the constants change as a function of time? Or that the value of the constants in one country is different from another, or different between a city and a rural area? Maybe the values of the constants are changing as people take different practices, for example, social distancing. I read a great quote in 538, I'll link the article in the description, about the difficulties of mathematical modeling. It's a little bit like saying you want to make an apple pie, but the instructions say it's somewhere between 3 and 15 apples. Or maybe you could use steaks or Brussels sprouts as well. The idea being that when we're actually trying to model something real world that's happening right now, this is an extremely complicated process. And I think the sort of toy models that I've introduced in this video give a nice introduction to the idea of how mathematicians can try to take different features of different diseases and represent them in a mathematical model. But this is only scratching the surface of the real and very challenging work that mathematicians and epidemiologists actually have to do to get a real predictive handle on the spread of any disease. If you enjoyed this video, give it a like for that YouTube algorithm. We're all mathematicians here. We like algorithms. YouTube likes algorithms. So give the video a like. If you have any questions, leave them down in the comments. And as always, we're going to do more math in the next video.